Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of Irongo Talk, our community, your news. My name is Leandria Lowe and I'll be your host for today. Now today I'm surrounded by beauty at the Eden Nursery in Wolfish Bay and today we celebrate World Youth Skills Day. Now in our program for today we are I'll be bringing you the news, the tides, the weather, and our interview for today is with Nadine Firi from the Scientific Society of Swakopmund, who's going to talk about Heritage Week that they are hosting in collaboration with the Museum Association of Namibia as well as the COSDEV Arts and Crafts Center. So don't go anywhere, we'll be right back after this. Now for your news. Now the first person, 45 years old, who died of COVID-19 in Namibia was laid to rest in Narawal yesterday afternoon. Now the governor of the Irongo region, Neville Andre, confirmed telephonically that the deceased would be buried. Now Andre said that strict World Health Organization protocols, guidelines and standard operating procedures would be enforced at COVID-19 related funerals. A small group of relatives, Ministry of Health officials, army personnel, council officials and operators of earth moving machines working at the burial site were in attendance at the solemn ceremony. Now the burial was preceded by a site visit and inspection by health ministry and military staff. Now a convoy of vehicles arrived at 5 o'clock and proceeded to the burial area where what appeared to be a service was conducted. Now Andre, who also witnessed the proceedings from a distance, confirmed that the municipality made the site available for the interment of COVID-19 related deaths after request by the Ministry of Health and Social Services. Now during the burial proceedings, a group of men clad in white protective suits were observed carrying the body of the deceased to its final resting place. Now a front end loader covered the grave with sand while family members dispersed, and the group of officials who handled the burial was sanitized and left the area. Now at the time a large group of worried residents living in the area nearby had converged, observing the proceedings from a distance. Now many said they were furious that the municipality had not consulted or informed them of the fact that persons who had died of COVID-19 would be buried within such close proximity to their homes. Now the Deputy Minister of Urban and Rural Development, Derek Klassen, who is a resident of the Harbour Town and resides in Narawal, called for calm. Now, quote, he said, "It is a sad day and the death of this patient came as a shock for all of us. This person is a Namibian and we should pay our last respects. Wolfish Bay is regarded as a COVID-19 epicenter and it appears if things are getting worse. Now, decongestion portions of Kwisabond is therefore of utmost importance and the ministry is in talks with NHE to avail Ervin for this purpose. Now, my personal opinion is that we should fast track Farm 37 to decongest Kwisabond," he said. Now, an official from the municipality said earlier this week that graves of persons who died of COVID-19 would be dug to a depth of 2.5 meters. Now, such persons are not buried in coffins but in body bags. They are also injected with a certain substance to ensure that their body disintegrate completely within a number of days, the official said, who spoke on a condition of anonymity. He gave the assurance that the area allocated for COVID-19 related deaths would be properly sealed off to prevent members of the public from accessing it. Now, since last night, there's a petition going around that was started by a Narawal resident where they are saying that they don't want the burial site to be this close to their homes. So please go check out our Facebook and our website for more details on that story. Our colleague also went live on our Facebook page, but from a distance, about the burial yesterday. Now in more Afrikaans news, Walvis Beyers bevind homself ten midde van die COVID-19 storm met meer as 800 positiewe gevalle van die virus wat reeds landwyd aangemeld is. Nou Hannes Olivier, 74 jaar oud, glo vast dat die mensdom se beste wapen teen COVID-19 die dra van maskers is. Nou Olivier is 'n afgetrede meganiese ingenieur wat meeste van sy werksjare aan die Oosrand in Suid-Afrika deurgebring het. Na die inperking is hy op Walvis Beyers saam met sy suster gehok. Hy meen die pandemie is besig om verwoesting te saai. Die omvang van die skade sal waarskynlik nooit kan bereken word nie. Een waarheid is egter duidelik, die situasie is reeds katastrofies. Indien 'n teenmiddel nie vinnig gevind word nie, gaan elkeen van ons op een of ander tyd direk met die virus gekonfronteer word. Nou hy voel dat die gebruik van maskers is die beste manier vir ons om te wys dat ons gee om vir ons medemens op die einde van die dag. En hy voel dat hy beskou die versuim om masker te dra as asosiaal. Daar moet aangedring word op samenwerking in hierdie verband en so kan ons ander aanmoedig om vir mekaar om te gee. Hy het dit op so 'n mooi manier gestel en hierdie story kan julle ook baie graag op ons webwerf gaan lees. En dan ten laaste, disgruntled Wolfish Bay resident who recently tested positive for COVID-19 expressed his dissatisfaction at conditions at the isolation facility in Henties Bay where he was sent after he received his test results. Now there's been quite complaints from this isolation facility in Henties Bay. Now the complainant, who chose to remain anonymous, said that he is not pleased with the level of cleanliness at the Henties Bay Youth Civic Center, which was turned into an isolation facility for COVID-19 patients. Now he said, quote, there are 3 toilets in the block, but only one flushes. Only one of the taps from the basins we use to wash hands actually works. There is not even any hand sanitizer available, he said in a telephonic interview after he initially voiced his grievances by contact the Irongo 24/7 Facebook page. He also expressed his dismay at what he termed unacceptable overcrowding at the premises. The man who works as a contract manager for a cleaning company tasked to clean a hospital at the coast also said that the bathroom at the isolation facility does not have warm water. When approached for comment about the issues, Irongo Governor Neville Andre said that quarantine patients have no choice in deciding which isolation or quarantine facility they will be placed in. In a text message, he said that he had not been informed by those in charge of the facility that there were issues pertaining to my bad. Now, the contractor appointed to repair the toilets went to Henties Bay to conduct the much needed repairs. And then he said, thank you for informing me. It is receiving the necessary attention. According to the complainant, the soap dispenser in the bathroom was also constantly empty. He also complained about the absence of paper towels in the dispenser at the bathroom, adding that there are no dustbins in the toilets and the bathrooms. Now, the governor disputed this, saying that there are cleaners that have been hired to clean the premises. Now, another issue raised by the complainant is about being one of 5 patients who had not received food on his first day at the facility. The governor promised that the complaints will be addressed as soon as possible. He said that I will speak to my colleagues to find out whether these issues have been raised with them and they can look into these issues so that we can deal with it, he said. Now, that's your news for today. Please go check out our website at www.irongo.com.na for this and much more news.
So we are here with Nadine, who is an assistant curator at the Swakopmund Museum. Hi Nadine, how are you?
Good, thank you. How are you?
I'm fine. So Nadine, the pandemic came and gave us all a run for our money. So how has the scientific society been affected by COVID-19?
Well, obviously, we went into lockdown a little bit earlier than most businesses. Yeah. As soon as the school closed, all the museums were closed in the country as well. Mm-hmm. So from the middle of March until the beginning of June, we were closed. Mm-hmm. So 2 months, 3 months of income lost. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, we are a tourist place. so we rely heavily on tourism. There are no tourists in the moment. So in the moment, we have to remarket ourselves completely. We have to think of how we can approach the locals more and, yeah, get our funds in that we need to keep running this museum.
Okay, and Nadine, with that, the museum and the scientific society are known for having sort of events centered around Namibia, its people, its history. What events have had to take a knee to the COVID-19 pandemic?
I think one of the biggest events that we wanted to host this year was our Curiosity Week. Mm-hmm. We had it planned to be in May during the holidays, specifically designed for high school students, mm-hmm. to show them career paths that they could possibly take. Mm-hmm. And we were so excited because we had been planning this for about a year. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, Corona comes and it's gone. So we haven't forgotten about Curiosity Week, but we had to postpone it. And it looks like we're only going to be able to do it next year because it's uncertain times. Then another favorite of ours was Ocean Week. Now, usually we do some activities at the museum or try to get the community. We wanted to get the community together this year to go and have a beach cleanup. Mm-hmm. Yeah, didn't happen. Corona was there, right? So we had to completely rephase it by actually going online. Yeah. So our whole Ocean Week had been posted online. So we did the whole exhibition, so to say, online. So mm-hmm. we really had to rethink everything from reaching our audiences.
So this year was going to be the first year that you would have hosted Curiosity Week, I believe, and then Ocean Week as well. So could you tell our viewers a little bit more about what Curiosity Week and Ocean Week respectively entail?
All right, so Curiosity Week, what the Scientific Society of Swakopmund, what they really want to do is to help the education sector. So we found that many youngsters don't know what jobs are out there. Yeah. Right? They don't know what they want to do after grade 12. They have no cooking clue of the variety that is out there. So we wanted to introduce these youngsters to real people doing those jobs. So we had people from doing architecture, to IT, to journalism, to conservation, to teachers, would come in, do almost like a roundtable talk show, like we're doing now, but with these students in the audience so that they could ask questions, getting to know the jobs, and at the same time have a whole exhibition on these individuals showing their lives in that career. Yeah. Ocean Week, we did it last year on a very small scale to see what interest there is. Now this year we wanted to do it bigger and better. This year the theme was 30 by 30, so in other words, 30% of oceans should be safe by 2030, mm-hmm. right? So we wanted to create awareness of our oceans and also of the oceans in Namibia. Mm-hmm. So what we did is we wanted to have exhibitions at the museum, have people come in, maybe organize a beach cleanup, get professionals in to do lectures. Yeah, like I said, didn't happen, Corona happened.
Yeah.
But if you check on our Facebook page, Instagram, and we even have a YouTube channel now, you can see all the videos that we posted online. So we have a maritime virtual tour. We have ex-marine biologist explaining about our coastline, and we have OCN from Wolfish Bay talking about how they save their seals.
Yep.
So very interesting, so go have a look. That is what we did for Ocean Week this year.
Okay, so then how big a problem do you feel that ocean conservation is at this point? Do you think we are getting somewhere, or do you think it's all just falling on deaf ears?
I think there's always room for improvement. That's my slogan. I think there is people who take it very seriously, and then I think there's people, you know, which don't care at all. Yeah. And I think it's important that especially we living at the coast, and especially us as the museum and us as the Scientific Society Swakopmund, take that approach to see or tell the people, look, there is room for improvement. Let's work together. Because the fact is, we can only save the ocean if we work together. And that's what we as Wakob Munders need to realize, that if we want to make a difference, we need to work together. And we've got the platform to sort of talk about that topic of ocean conservation, so we're using it.
Of course. And then there are still some events on the calendar for the rest of the year. Could you tell us a little bit about what the Scientific Society is hoping to still host in this year?
All right. So currently we're working on quite a big project in association with the Museums Association of Namibia and other museums all over the country. Every September we host the Heritage Week. Mm-hmm. Now, if you know, last year the Heritage Week was a huge event for the Swakop Munt Museum. We had all about music, we had a parade through town, it was loads of fun. Mm-hmm. So we're hoping that by September our restrictions will be lifted a little bit so that we can host Heritage Week again. Mm-hmm. In the same line as we did last year with workshops happening, we're not counting on getting students in this year, let's be realistic about it, but we're kind of looking at a broader spectrum this year to see if we can't include all ages. And there's some fun events that we are planning. We're just waiting how restrictions are gonna be like that time. But if restrictions are still in place like they are currently for the Erongo region, we do have a backup plan. And we'll be recording loads of videos during that week. Oh. So in other words, if we can't do an in-person thing, then we'll be doing an online show, definitely.
Yeah, bringing it to the people. So then, of course, you just mentioned that the museum and the Scientific Society is largely reliant on tourism, which is obviously bowed out in the time of the pandemic. So how are you preparing should the pandemic and the lockdown and all these measures end? How is the Scientific Society preparing to get back up and running again?
Well, hopefully Heritage Week will be our first thing that gets us up and running again. Also this time because we're collaborating with COSDEF, so we're hoping that there will be something coming that way. More exposure for COSDEF, more exposure for us. I think we can't expect tourism too much probably for the next couple of months. So we're focusing on locals. So we're thinking about exhibitions, lectures that could interest local people. We're thinking of what specials can we run, who can we collaborate with to maybe make packages or whatever. But at this point, we also rely very heavily on ideas that come from the outside. Yeah. So if anyone has an idea what they find the Swakop Munt Museum could do to maybe get in funds, or if there are any sponsors out there who would like to contribute in helping us keep the Swakop Munt Museum running, then you know what, our doors are always open, especially my door. Feel free to come to the Swakop Munt Museum. We have a special running right now in the moment. It's you buy one ticket or you buy for your family tickets, and it's valid until the end of July. Mm-hmm. It's actually cheap. So please come support us. We really, the whole focus is really, we as Swakop Munt, we need to stand together.
Yes.
And we need the Swakop Munders also to keep us going. And that's what we're trying to achieve with Heritage Beginning, that there is solidarity and unity in all of us, and helping also other local businesses to just keep going and to get through this.
Okay, thank you, Nadine. There we have it, the latest and greatest from the Scientific Society of Swakop Munt.
And now for your weather and tides. We had high tide this morning at 24 minutes past 5, low tide at 10 minutes to 12. High tide will be again at 28 minutes past 5, and low tide will be at exactly midnight tonight. Now, sunrise in Wolfish Bay was this morning at 7:45. Sunset will be at 26 minutes to 7. Now, this is more or less the times for the rest of the regions as well, sunrise and sunset. Now, Wolfish Bay, a maximum temperature of 26 degrees Celsius are expected for today with an east-northeasterly wind. Now this morning my sinuses was already telling me it's going to be east weather. Now for tomorrow, minimum will be 20 degrees Celsius, maximum will be 27 degrees Celsius. For Sokopmund, maximum for today will be 24 degrees Celsius with a south-southeasterly wind. For tomorrow, minimum will be 19 degrees Celsius and a maximum of 24 degrees Celsius. For Aantees Bay, maximum for today will be 26 degrees Celsius with the east wind. And then for tomorrow, the minimum will be 16 degrees Celsius with a maximum of 26 degrees Celsius. For Arandas, maximum will be 30 degrees Celsius with a northeasterly wind. Minimum will be 15 degrees Celsius and a maximum of 32 degrees Celsius for tomorrow. For Usakos, maximum for today will be 27 degrees Celsius with an east-northeasterly wind. For tomorrow, the minimum will be 8 degrees Celsius with a maximum of 28 degrees Celsius. For Karibop, maximum will be 25 degrees Celsius with a northeasterly wind, a minimum of 8 degrees Celsius for tomorrow and a maximum of 26 degrees Celsius for tomorrow. For Oamaruru, maximum will be 25 degrees Celsius for today with an east-northeasterly wind, and then for tomorrow with a minimum of 5 degrees Celsius and a maximum of 25 degrees Celsius. That's your weather and tides for today and tomorrow. And that's it for today. Please go check out our website at www.irongo.com.na for all the latest news. Please follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, or drop us a WhatsApp text at 0811-7040. It's almost weekend, so hang in there. We'll see you again tomorrow. Keep on sanitizing, wear your mask. We'll see you again. Bye!